Hi, friends. Welcome to the Greater Reading Area Dance Exchange. Together, we'll make the grade. I'm Jessica Warchal King, founder and director of JCWK Dance Lab. The mission of JCWK Dance Lab is to create joy, connection, and wellness through kinesthetic stories. Today, I want to spend some time unpacking what kinesthetic stories mean through the lens of performance process and practice. We'll be talking with Sean Sassman, director of Reading Theater Project's 5-Minute Fringe, about the embodied and creative process of developing the performance, which is coming up next week. I'll also be talking with dance artists Ariel Ridley and Katie Monistat. But first, I want to let you know about a few things that are happening in the Berks County area. WH Dance Academy, Berks Ballet Theater, Visions Dance Company continue to offer dance classes for adults. Cyphers at the Square has moved to the Goggle Works on Wednesdays at 8 p.m. If there are other local dance organizations that are offering classes, workshops, or opportunities for folks, please let me know through email or by completing the form at the GRADE website. Thank you. A little bit beyond our region, the Lehigh Valley Dance Exchange is offering adult classes at Cedar Crest College on Monday and Thursday evenings. And for all things Philadelphia dance, check out philadelphiadance.org. The Pennsylvania Dance Education Organization is strongly advocating for a direct path to dance teacher certification in the K-12 setting. Please support the advancement of dance education in Pennsylvania by checking out their website, joining the organization, and learning about what they and you can do. And now, what are kinesthetic stories? Kinesthetic is an academic word for body. So kinesthetic stories are stories our bodies tell. Our posture, the way we walk or talk, or take up space, or use our hands, are informed by our stories. I think dance allows us to know our bodies more and therefore understand ourselves a bit more. Let's go behind the scenes for some of the stories that are being told as part of Reading Theater Project's 5-Minute Fringe. The Greater Reading Area Dance Exchange. We are so excited to have you as part of this episode because the Reading Theater Project's 5-Minute Fringe is such a part of the artistic community in Berks County. And I'm very excited to go behind the scenes a little bit with you into what happens at these creative labs. At the beginning of the call, it's announced that everyone has to participate in a creative lab. And so can you tell me a little bit more about what that participation means in addition to the participation in the actual performance?
Right. Well, first off, Jessica, thank you so much for having me. It's always a great pleasure to get to work with you, especially during the Fringe season. The creative labs are kind of the most important part of the Fringe process because everything we're doing with Fringe is new. Everyone is writing and creating their own works, whether it is choreographed dances, new pieces of music, monologues, scenes. It really runs the gamut of theatrical performance. And the creative labs are the opportunities for the creators and performers to get feedback on their work from not just the creative team behind the project, but also everybody else involved in Fringe. And those creative labs is really where you start to see the threads that connect all of the different pieces start to form. It is community-led feedback sessions. The creators are invited to let us know what they want feedback on specifically, so that way we can give them the most helpful ideas and new paths of creativity that they need.
Thank you, Sean. And what was really amazing, I think there are a couple of things that I want to touch upon, but this is all new material.
Yeah.
And so how do you talk to new material or material that's still in development or that's being tried out for the first time, maybe at one of these creative labs or in performance at the Fringe? What kind of feedback do you give? How do you get feedback? You asked specifically what the artists need, but how do you guide that? Because I love watching you guide that. I love you figuring out how to ask the question in a way that the artists understand what you're looking for, but also makes the artists think a little bit deeper about what they're looking for as well.
Mm-hmm. I think the most important part to remember is exactly what you said, is that these pieces are all in development. They're not coming to the first creative lab with a finished piece. A lot of the pieces that we received submissions on this year started out as just an outline or a three sentence, this is kind of what I'm thinking of sort of description. Very rarely does any piece that we receive for Fringe that comes to us as like a script or a fully developed monologue end up the same way come performance dates. So I think that's really the first thing that we try to keep in mind, is that everything has room to grow. And then as to how do you ask the question of what does a creator need, it really depends on a piece by piece basis. A lot of the folks that are kind of working on the Fringe Festival, between myself, the artistic director of Reading Theater Project, Vicky Holograph, and our stage manager, Jewel Brown, we all have more of a theatrical training. We're used to scenes and monologues and that sort of thing. And then when we get submissions from folks like yourself and from Arielle Ridley, who are dancers by nature, it becomes really exciting to learn a new vocabulary. And so that's kind of a lot of the process, is discovering what kind of vocabulary do we need to have with one another so that we can help each other develop these pieces and create a product that not only are we proud of, but that the audience will enjoy.
Sean, I think that's so fascinating. The idea of a shared vocabulary, even though the language, the technical language is different. Something that I hear so often was that, well, I don't know anything about dance, but this is what I saw. And then the person giving the feedback or what they saw goes into this like elaborate movement pathway where they're actually also embodying the theme, but their own interpretation of whatever that experience that the dancer was sharing on stage. And I think that's so interesting to say, well, I don't know anything about this, but I'm doing it.
Yeah. And that's one of the things that I learned really early on as I was going to school for theater and that kind of training, is that experiences aren't necessarily universal, but emotion is. And that's something that we can all relate to at the end of the day. So as long as you're feeling something, you're experiencing the piece in a way that it was intended to.
I love that. Can you talk a little bit more about intention? And what does that mean? What does that feel like? Let me talk about feelings. What does that feel like? Mm-hmm. And then in terms of intention, how do you build those? How do you find those threads that kind of pulse through the whole curation of the Fringe Festival?
It starts with looking at the big picture. So this season's theme is wrestling, with the word rest kind of highlighted. So we started with these kind of two opposed concepts of stillness and chaos, and finding within the pieces, some of them will latch on more to one, such as there's a couple pieces that really tie into the rest theme and sleeping and that sort of thing. And then there are these more explosive pieces with movement in them that better encapsulate the wrestling aspect. And it's finding the bridge between those two things that is what makes this process so fascinating for us, and makes it a journey that we all kind of collectively go on together. And, you know, writers all have different intentions with what they're creating, just as dancers do as they choreograph new pieces. And finding the common threads of intention of what do these pieces want the audience to be thinking about? What do they want them to feel? What do the actors feel as they're, you know, embodying these characters through either their body or their words? And that's really kind of what we dig into with the creative labs, is where are all of these threads and how can we put them together and put them up in a way that it makes sense for an audience.
Do you have any suggestions for somebody who is new either to Reading Theater Project or The Fringe or theater or dance, or is, that'll be one question. Do you have any, do you have any suggestions for experiencing something that they haven't experienced before?
I have a lot. the most important thing is to go into it with an open mind. The minute you start telling yourself, I can't do this, is the moment you become unable to do anything. And that's what makes Fringe so exciting, is that it gives folks the opportunity to start creating something new when they otherwise wouldn't. One of the things that Vicky always talks about is it's a little intimidating to try to write a full-length play or even a one act. But starting with a 5-minute scene or a short monologue to be performed is a lot more possible to people. And that's what Fringe gives people the opportunity to do, is let's start small. And then if this is something that you're truly passionate about and that you want to explore further, you can do that after the Fringe Festival.
History.
So I started dancing when I was 3, and I started at a small studio in Reading, and then I kind of graduated to Berks Ballet Theatre, and I danced there until I was about 13. So you can imagine I did the Nutcracker, I did various spring performances. I danced in their company when I was a teenager. And then I took a 4-year hiatus when I was in high school from dance, but I still engaged in the arts, in band, chorus, musical theater. And by the time I got to college at Temple University, I saw how rich the like art culture was in Philly. And I said to myself, I have to get reconnected with dance. So I auditioned for the the dance department at Temple, and from there I got in, and I spent 4 years getting my BFA in dance performance. And from there, after I graduated, I moved back here to Berks County, and I got certified as a dancing mindfulness facilitator. So then I started combining therapy and mindfulness and dance and expressive arts, and kind of flourished it into this like beautiful marriage of the mind, body, and the soul. Awesome. And here I am. It feels like a different experience going from Philadelphia to small town Reading in Berks County. And I guess what I would like to see is more of a art culture, I guess in terms of dance, because that's just where I'm rooted and I'm grounded in, and just to see ways for the community to connect through dance, especially all that we've been through the past few years. And I feel like dance is one of those outlets that connects people in so many different ways. Personally, just meeting myself where I'm at, and I think that's a beautiful thing about dance, is that you can take it and mold it and transform it into whatever that means for you. I know that there's so many different styles and forms of dance, and even like thinking like from a cultural standpoint, like dance has meaning for people. Dance tells stories, and when you move, when you're speaking, you're saying something, whether it's about yourself or an experience, and it's just in that moment. It doesn't, and can tell a story about the past and the future, but you reflect on how it's impacting you now.
My name is Arielle Ridley. I have been dancing since I took it seriously when I was 13. I just graduated from school last year from AMDA College and Conservatory, the LA and New York campus. I love to dance in contemporary. I love to really express myself in all kinds of weird ways, whether that's rolling on the floor, a lot of weird arm movement. That's my style. I really wanted to be a part of Fringe this year, because after working with Reading Theater Project for a little bit, they're not only they're just really kind people, but they're really supportive of all art forms, performance art, and then all painting and sculpture and all that types of art. They love all of it and they embrace all of it. And even if it's like an art that one of us doesn't understand, we can always appreciate it. So being a part of that type of culture really made me want to take the step and try to present my own choreography for the first time. My piece is called The Cycle, and it's about getting stuck in a repetition or a sort of a rut of some sort, whether that's creatively, physically, financially, just the mundane of everyday life. You kind of get stuck in it sometimes. And I really want the audience to feel like they can connect to what I'm trying to express on the stage. There is a lot of dance happening in Berks County, but it's kind of hard to find, to be honest. No one's really trying to be exclusive or anything like that. It's just communities can be communities. And sometimes you just don't even realize that something's happening right next to you, whether that's because of communication or marketing or scheduling or whatever. It's just sometimes you just don't see it. So I would love for the communities, all of them, to get together and have more events involving each other in all types of dance, and for that community to spread and grow, and that will attract other dancers from other areas, and it can become a beautiful
experience for everybody, where everyone can train or take class or perform, share works, create together. Just a big, happy family, honestly.
You said start small. And I'm so grateful, one, for that permission to start small, two, because it embodies, still grateful, but it embodies the steps and the growth that I view, not only our creative process, but also the way that Ready Theater Project has operated. Small, intentional, really impactful things that have become so rich and then grow. And so I'm really grateful that the Fringe is a model for creative process, but is also a model of what Reading Theater Project is and how the organization collaborates and kind of layers and builds together. It's really organic and it's really exciting to be a part of and also witness. So thank you for that demonstration of organic growth and also the intentionality of small things blossoming.
One of the, I heard this phrase a couple years ago back while I was still in college, and it stuck with me for a while. And it was this phrase that there's no glory in the process. And it's this idea that when you're doing something that is reaching an audience, the audience might not necessarily care about how you got there. They want to see what the finished product is. But I think as artists, we're so fascinated by the process. We want to know, how did you get from A to B? How did you get from a script on a page to actors moving in a space? How did a dancer go from here's a piece of music to here is how my body moves to this piece of music and how I am conveying emotion? And that's just something that's always stuck with me, because I think there is inherently a glory in the process.
Yes, there's power in the process. And I think demonstrating the importance of practice is so also important. The layers of practice. Well, this is the first draft. This is the second draft. This is the third draft. I don't know where this is going. But circling back and circling back and circling back to be able to produce that thing and having a deadline is beautiful as well.
I am one of those people where if you're going to give me a task, I need a deadline. Otherwise, it's just going to keep getting put off or like reworked continuously. So,
and that's also, again, the neat thing about Fringe is that there's this opportunity to receive audience feedback as part of the performance, both informally and a little bit formally. Somebody who is coming out of the past 2 years and wants to experience this, the Reading Theater Project's 5-Minute Fringe in a new way, can you talk about that, about what's also gonna happen in terms of the theater setup and that the coming into the theater experience?
Yeah, so it's been a long time since we've done in-person things. And, you know, last year, our Fringe Festival was entirely virtual. We did video submissions for everything that were compiled, and they're up on YouTube to watch. And they'll live there until the end of time, or until YouTube decides to take them down, whatever happens first, I guess. But there's nothing like doing live theater. Or live dance or live performance in general. It's a communal shared experience that exists for a moment and then it's gone. And I think that's what we all kind of do it for within the arts community. That said, we're still taking precautions. Every single member of the crew and cast of this Fringe Festival is vaccinated. And we are requiring audiences to wear masks while inside the building. Well, inside the Yoakum Institute, because we not only want to keep ourselves safe, but we want to make sure that the audience feels comfortable in their surroundings and having this shared communal experience that we've all been missing so much.
Yes, for people as they start to explore all of the ambiguities that Fringe allows for, and maybe explore something that they haven't experienced yet?
Keep an open mind and know that there is not one correct answer. I think we're all trained and conditioned to believe that, you know, the window is a metaphor for this specific thing. But that's not going to be true for every single person. Every single member of the audience is going to take something different away from what they see during the Fringe Festival, just like every actor takes something different away from a scene, or every dancer takes something different away from a piece of music. There's no right way to experience a live event, but the important thing is that you're experiencing it.
Thank you so much for joining me for this episode of the Greater Reading Area Dance Exchange. I look forward to dancing with you, hearing about the ways that you are excited about dance, and seeing you at the 5-Minute Fringe. Take care. Be safe.
JCWK Dance Lab, creating joy, connection, and wellness through kinesthetic stories.